It's Thursday, so it's hashtag Justice Thursdays, and where we have conversations demystifying access to justice and looking at what we all need to do so we can ensure speedy delivery of justice. Our guest this morning is the Chief Magistrate and Chairperson of the National Council and Administration of Justice Special Committee on Court Users Committees.
I think you need to add one word just to balance things out.
And that word
of
is?
Kenya.
See, it's done.
repeat that again. It's lengthy. I need to wrap my head around it.
He is a chief magistrate.
That much I've got.
He is also the chairperson of the National Council on Administration of Justice Special Committee on Court Users Committees.
Okay. I've also got that one. But I'm sure I'll get it better as we go along.
Yes.
Yes.
His name is the Honorable Abdulkadir Lorot. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. How are you, Eric?
Very well. Good to have you. And how many L's and R's are in your name? Hey, I had to read it 17 times. Abdulkadir Lorot.
Actually, the second name, I have worked most of my career in the central part of the country. So it is the L coming in a hurry. So for those who would like to twang, they say Rorot.
Abdulkadir Lorot.
So if the L and R is disturbing, combine them.
Yeah, like an L is coming after an R.
Very shortly. And
it's a red lorry, yellow lorry situation.
Surely. Thank you very much for joining us in the Situation Room.
Thank you very much for having me.
We call this the hot seat. It's right here. It's the bench, and you're on the bar.
I don't drink.
We have reversed roles. So let's start by understanding all these things. Okay, we know about the National Council on Administration of Justice, but there's a new term now that we're introducing today. The Court Users Committees. What's that?
Well, the Court Users Committee, in a very brief, if I were to just give a very brief description of it, it's just an assembly of the justice chain at its lowest level. That means that this is where we group together all the justice actors at the lowest level of the justice chain, which is in our case the lowest independent court, which is the magistrate's court at the lowest level. And we have it in three tiers. That means that we have it at the court level, and then at the county level, which is where we have the presiding judges in the counties, and then we have it now. NCAJ, as you know it, is a CUC, but of the leaders of the justice actors who are now represented at the lowest level. And each court user is significantly different from the other because the issues at the court level will be different, and the actors sometimes are different. Because what would be a very big issue in one station may not necessarily be a big issue in another. In fact, may be missing absolutely. If I may, for example, we know that you may have a Chang'an, a very big issue in sections of Central and Rift and possibly Western, but it's not an issue in the Northern sections of the country. So you wouldn't have those types of actors coming in into play. You have areas where terrorism is a big issue, so you would have the actors in the anti-terror department joining in as part and parcel of the court user committees, because those issues are discussed at the court user levels on expeditious disposal of cases. So
typically, who are the members of a court users committee?
First, I think it's important to give you a brief history where this has come from.
Yes.
Because even NCAJ itself is a product of the CUC conversation. I will start I'll not take you very far back, because it really starts way, way back.
Start way, way back.
So that Muga wants way, way back.
Yeah, because I want...
There's a conversation about history.
Way, way back for us.
Yes.
It may not be way, way back for you.
Way, way back for you, maybe just the other day.
Yes.
So If you were to typically look at the justice system in the country, in the way back, you'd see that the manifestation of the of justice is the courts. Okay, so take typically that your case has gone to court, and it has been adjourned, and you're mama mboga for use of. Let me just use the cliche. And when you're reporting back at home, how will you say that my case, how did it go? Koti iliahirisha kesi yangu. Deep down, the actors know what possibly would have resulted in this adjournment. Mm. Maybe the prosecutor, maybe the court was not sitting. Like today, some of my cases have been affected because I have come here. I will proceed back to court. Mm. But I'm sure some will not proceed because the time that I'm likely to spend in court will be slightly affected by this. Mm. So that person will have typically have to adjust to the fact that possibly it's a court that has caused, but they will not know. Mm-hmm. The cause may be that a prosecutor is missing in court or not, is not there, or is, could it be either the court or the prosecutor is unwell. Mm. It could be the police file was not brought to court for a myriad of reasons, or the probation report is not ready, or the children's report that's being awaited is not ready, or an analyst report from the government chemist has not been produced, has not been brought. A myriad of reasons would result in this adjournment. Mm. But for the typical mwananchi out there, the face of this conversation is the court. Koti iliahirisha kesi yangu. So what happened is that now this is not very, very, very back. So typically the actors in the justice chain did not have an engagement platform. So we would not know the challenges each actor is facing in the discharge of their specific mandate towards achieving justice. So we are all cluttered in our own silos. So in 2003, we can have a new government. Mm. Kenyans were considered the most hopeful nation on earth, and we have Kibaki as our president. Mm. And the first, I think what happened is that our then Chief Justice, Bernard Chunga, had to resign.
Yes.
Specific reasons, I think, is in the public domain. Mm. And then the highest ranking judge of the court at the time, the highest court was the Court of Appeal, was Justice Evans Kisheru. Mm. So he was the highest judge at that level, and then he was appointed Chief Justice by President Kibaki. Mm-hmm. His first task of business is to clean up the court. So he set up a committee. The committee was chaired by Justice Aaron Ringera, and had its members, Justice Paul Kariuki. Now the AG, mm-hmm, was a member of that committee. We had Justice Onyango Otieno also as a member, and a few others, others that are not usually mentioned. Mm. That includes the secretary, who was now Judge Christine Mioli, and a few others. So they went around the country collecting views from members of the public, because Kenyans had managed at that time to fix the legislature, because we had also managed to fix our executive. Mm. We had a president who was now loved, and Kenyans were hopeful that we were moving forward.
Yeah.
So the bastion that needed, in their view, reform was us. I think you know what happened. They called it the radical surgery, or some quarters call it surgery by radicals. Mm-hmm. But the result was 82 magistrates and about half of the judges. You know, in the law, judges were capped at 40.
Yeah.
So we had a lot of us now, some of my colleagues were sent home. By that, what was called the purge. Mm. It was an awakening call, I think, from those of us who were inside. And I think in terms of reflection, we asked ourselves, is it that some may have gone home for good reasons, for reasons that they, within their domain, they would know that it's okay. Mm. But there are others who were sent home unfairly, in their view. Yeah. And I think some came back through the tribunals that you have. Some of our best judges that we have, because a process like that would generally have to be taken through a process and then checked and rechecked. But I'm not discussing the purge, but the purge was an awakening call for us on the bench. Mm-hmm. And we now had a conversation internally, and the internal conversation was a reflection. Is it that
Kenyans don't understand what we do, or is it the how we do it, or possibly there's a disconnect between some of the resources or things or the tools of how we're carrying out business.
Mm-hmm.
Forgotten in the Ringera's report was some of the groundbreaking recommendations, including how to ensure that we have independence of the justice sector, mm-hmm. how we had to have a sector-wide consultation, and how we have to have stakeholder engagement within the justice chain.
Mm-hmm.
This is also the time that the GJ laws was being formed, the justice, the governance, justice and law order sector reform program was mm-hmm. coming into force. So ultimately, we had this conversation internally and held meetings. We were the Kenya Magistrates and Judges Association, which I served as first, I think, as an official in the council, and then thereafter as its Secretary General. When we had this conversation with partners, with the Kenya National Commission on Human Rights, which had just come into force, with other actors as well. So we developed what we call the transparency and accountability mechanism, which were in threefold. The first one was a peer-to-peer mechanism, a peer review, as we call it.
Mm.
And then the second one, we piloted what was called a citizen dialogue card, and which was piloted in 14 court stations. And this pilot, it's like an exit poll of your experience in the court.
Mm. At
the end of your court session, case. What is your... so?
At the end of a session or the end of a case?
At the end of a session. Not a case, every session. So, and then we even had someone employed.
Mm.
To now mine this data for purposes of seeing what the data would speak to us mm. about. And then ingrained in this was also the first Judiciary Open Day, which was held in February of 2007,
mm.
where all judges across the country and all magistrates across the country congregated at the Kenyatta International Conference Center. And then we displayed for the public all our divisions, all mm. our things, what we do. And then we had a conversation with the public.
Mm.
The Kenya Magistrates and Judges Association had a tent. And in the tent, we carried a survey. We had actually, through the services, through the help of GIZ, then it was called GTZ,
mm.
they helped us have a consultant. And the consultant was to take data from
The public. From the public. Anybody who was just passing by.
No, passing our
tent
was very popular
mm.
because this is where all the judges and magistrates are represented.
Yeah.
And we had thought that the public complained a lot about integrity issues. But at that time, the results was displayed in a pie chart and mm. it showed that nearly 90% of the complaints were about what we now call case resolution, case mm. backlog. Mm. So like the turnaround of cases from mm. inception to conclusion, the turnaround. There were cases that had been in the system and have been in the system for years, decades.
Mm.
Some even before the sitting judge was born. And this is serious.
Yeah. So that's interesting that you say that, because then my question would have been, with all this information that has been collected, we're talking about months and months.
This is history still.
Right.
There was action now mm. after that.
Mm-hmm. That was the next question, because now with all of this, then what was done? Because as you talk about the case backlog being one of the bones of contention, 90%,
At that time.
But it still seems to be an issue today.
Yes.
So how then were some of these things resolved with the information at that point in time,
we now wondered, because then we now had to look back and ask ourselves as courts. We were taking the flag for a lot of other actors. So then there was a need for us to start speaking to each other. Then one of the accountability mechanisms that we developed was court user committees
mm-hmm.
to start at the smallest level at these piloted stations. And our Chief Justice was then in Nakuru, and she was one of those who spearheaded the court user committees in Nakuru.
Mm-hmm.
We had success stories of court user committees established, and then they had conversations on how to reduce backlog at their local level
mm-hmm.
to have local solutions for local problems.
Mm-hmm.
Because like I said, there is no, we don't have a, it's everything is sui generis.
It's not homogenous.
Yeah, there's no homogeneity in terms of how each court addresses its issues.
Mm.
There would be certain standards. So that's what my committee now is about, setting certain irreducible minimums in terms of standards at the court levels. So when we established the court user committees, and then we started to put them and to ingrain them as part of our structures, they were dependent really on the leadership and the charisma of the individual leader at the court level. Mm-hmm. And to bring in, then there were, even the membership was as colorful as the rainbow. You would find in one different membership, in different membership. So there was then need to put some guidelines on how to
set some structure
of this. Mm. Even before the constitution, this was, you can imagine, this is even before, because NCJ is now a creature of statute pursuant to the constitution. Mm. So come in the former, so we had guidelines, but come in the former Minister for Justice, the late Mutula Kilonzo. Mm. He set up a committee chaired by Justice William Ouko, now a judge of the Supreme Court, mm. and a former registrar of the High Court. His committee, which had KMJ represented at its by its highest level, that is, Justice Lenaola was our chairperson at the time. What happened is that committee came with serious recommendations, which I've now seen. And I think it would have been these recommendations that formed the chapter on the judiciary mm-hmm. in the constitution, because I represented the judiciary as a member of the reference group in the run-up to the processes of constitutional making. So then they set up the Judicial Service Act, and at section 34 and 35 establishes then the NCJ. So now we have NCJ. Mm. The NCJ has its membership addressed, and I'm sure somebody has spoken to it about it before, but if not, I will speak to it. Mm. So its membership is the traditional leaders of actors. It is just coincidental that we have the Chief Justice as the chairperson and then the Chief Registrar of the Judiciary as the secretary, mm-hmm. for the reason that the Chief Registrar as the secretary is also the owner of the pass. The pass for funding the NCJ mm-hmm. emanates from the Judiciary Fund. Mm-hmm. Of course, now it's in the process of being operationalized. Yes. One word that I think a lot of people can say. I try.
It's another
Lorot situation. So therefore we now have the section 34 establishes, but an important function of the NCJ is to establish court user committees at the county and station levels. So from 2012 we were trying to put structures to the CUC. Mm. You see, CUC CUCs were there before even the NCJ was set up.
Yeah.
So now it was about putting them in some form of structure and ensuring that it no longer depended on charisma, that it now forms part and parcel of the process of justice. And we even developed values for it. We have had biennial conferences where we have brought all the actors. Mm. So each court station selects three persons from each CUC to attend a biennial conference. You will be shocked at the kaleidoscope of persons who would come, and you would have matatu operator, matatu owner representative, in another place someone from Nyumba Kumi, but the traditional ones who generally find themselves is the magistrate who is the chair or judge who is the chair, and the probation officer or children's officer. These have traditionally been our secretaries, and then DPP.
Brings me back to that question then.
Yes.
Who are the members, the typical members of a court user committee?
So we have the court, the chair is the head of station.
Okay.
Or the court, the person is in charge of the station. This is the judicial officer or judge for the county. Mm. And then we now have the DPP represented. We have members of LSK. We have persons from the office of the Attorney General. We have the prisons department. We have all police representation. That means from the station commanders to criminal investigators to administration police. I mean, we have them in their in their formations. Then we have representatives from civil society. We also have representatives from youth, women. In some places, we have also we have membership from the clergy. I'll give an example of Eldoret. When they hold their meetings in the past, they have to take the town hall, because there were very many, and they would have the bishop attend. The late Bishop Koril was always a member of the CUC, and he attended in person. Mm. So we would have members of the clergy. When I chaired the CUC for Kapsabet, I had all the clergy there, because there were some issues that we were seeing in court that needed solutions outside of judicial processes that required the clergy to speak to. For example, we had a few cases of bestiality, persons having carnal knowledge of animals, and this was shocking. So the clergy took charge of this to go and discuss this with
the community,
because this is some absurd situations.
I've listened. I don't hear participation of the political class.
I'm coming to that.
Okay.
Because CDF now emerged thereafter.
Mm.
In fact, we have had. I just want to say, I was coming to when I'll bring the political class, because they're not typically direct members. They send their representatives. We have the CDF managers as part and parcel. In mm-hmm. some instances, we have the county attorneys representing the county governments. In some instances, we have specific representation of county ministries.
Mm.
For example, if land is a very big issue in an area, we would have the CEC in charge of land.
Mm.
When I worked in Machakos, the CEC of land would attend our CEC meetings as a member directly, because there are issues that then would affect land. And the CUC can co-opt
uh-huh.
any number. And we would have some CUCs would have representation from CBOs that are local CBOs.
Mm.
They would even have international NGOs that are working in a specific area, in a specific line. For example, children NGOs or international non-government organizations, they would when they find themselves in an area and they have certain interests that they want to foster there, their efforts, so that they are not duplicated by others, we bring them together in the caucus, mm-hmm. and then because they have really helped us to understand that the depths of the impact of our decisions in court and the decisions of the justice chain. Yeah. We call ourselves the chain, because we think that we are chain linked, and our success is dependent on how we hold each other's hands. And like they say, a chain is as strong as its weakest link.
Mm.
That's another proverb for the day. we will try so much to look at where our weak link is and fix it,
and fix that,
and not point fingers, because then we would then work. Your weakness is my weakness. My strength should necessarily be your strength in the justice chain.
Right. We at least now get the background of what the CUCs are, how they came about, and what they're supposed to do. Now we'll get into the details of how they work and how they function, and what we expect to see from CUCs into the future. Kenya's Biggest Conversation continues with the Honorable Abdulkadir Lorot, a Chief Magistrate and Chairperson of the NCAJ Special Committee on Court Users Committees. We are discussing demystifying justice through court users committees. And Your Honor, just before we took the break, you'd gotten us to that point where now you are telling us the membership and the composition of a typical court users committee. Depending on the area, you'll see whatever is happening in an area, that will also determine who sits in the court users committee. When they come for a meeting in a court users committee, what is it that they bring? Is it that they are bringing the concerns of the people, or is it that they are putting the magistrate on the spot and saying, "Ye court yako fanye kazi"?
Actually, court user committee has now become a structure of stakeholder engagement, and the court is just first among equals. Everyone is equal. The court descends from its pedestal, and then sits. Now, we don't discuss cases that are ongoing.
Okay.
Because each particular agency that has a mandate, we call them duty bearers. And then the others that fill us up, like the representation from community, because that is what it is. What we do is we discuss areas of improving the delivery of justice. We discuss coordination of justice actors, so that in areas where, you know, you may find in a particular discharge of a mandate, there is overlap with another agency. So who then takes lead? Who in what area?
Mm.
Who does the court get as first instance? For example, just like we discuss issues do we need a mobile court in a particular area?
Mm.
Why do cases, police officers, when should they bring the police? If it is an area where there is heavy children issues, how do we ensure that children cases are then handled in the manner that is expected in the law? How do we do we give protection? So do we need to involve the witness protection agency? How do you contact small things? We also do training at that level also. You may find that a particular issue may be obvious to certain types of agency, but not obvious to everybody else. So we do training, for example, what is diversion? How do you move people from the justice system? And this is prosecutor, the Office of the Director of Public Prosecution that leads this. What is plea bargaining? So we do training on all these things so that we inform the members of the public how best we can improve the delivery of justice. So we do quite a number of things. But over and above, I think in the discussions, the most important thing is that we maintain our robust independence in terms of how we discharge our specific mandates. We don't discuss live cases. We may discuss a live case as an example of something that
of a challenge
or even a success.
A success.
We don't just discuss challenges. We also discuss successes. How and we even congratulate each other. But if nothing else, we give a platform to talk. If nothing else, it is an area where you can speak your issue. And then the issue either may be resolved today, tomorrow, but even if it is in the future, it was documented.
Do you find that then because of this, that users are then having a more of an intimate knowledge and understanding of the processes? Because, I mean, having been with it, as you've talked from your experience, before when nobody really knew what was going on, it was kind of like an over there, over here situation. Are we finding that even those who go through the process then are having an understanding of what's happening? So that even as you're going through these judicial processes, somebody has a case, somebody has an issue, there's an adjournment, this, that, the other thing, that people know what's happening and then they're a little more comfortable with the processes than they were before. So long and short of it, is it working?
I would think extremely well. If nothing else, I think the Cortes committees have shown that it is the platform to pitch any interventions in the justice chain, any policy. Because what happens is it's where we derive policy. Issues may emerge from the court user, from the court users, that when they are elevated to the National Council on Administration of Justice, they may result in either administrative action, policy direction, or legislative intervention. We have seen this. Right now, we have a task force chaired by a judge, Justice Ngenya. It's called the NCCJR, the National Committee on Criminal Justice Reforms, that is now looking at an overhaul of the criminal justice. This came from recommendations from the bottom. We had a committee that has now folded on bail and bond, discussing bail and bond issues, the criteria, what people need to do, and then the notices. Like when you have your Muga, if your brother is accused of an offense, we still consider him innocent until established guilty. So your brother is still innocent, and the court has bond now has become matter of automatic. So we will either give bond immediately or call for a pre-bail report. So even understanding that the role that I can now utilize social inquiry report from a probation office to now make this decision, this was not there before. This has all emerged because of engagement and now clearer responsibilities. Children officers were never in court in criminal cases. They were always there in just maintenance and dispute with respect to, but they are now involved in cases even where children are victims of crime. The civil society call them survivors. So when they are victims or survivors, so they are involved and they will want to know whether this child will come to court the next time. So we open a specific file for these are all things that have now emerged because of these discussions and discourse. So as implementing policy from up and implementing recommendations from the bottom, this is what court users have done. And over and above, solutions have emerged. Even issues like my conduct in court, I now know that from the CUC that I'm not saying I do, but probably we don't speak loudly. Like I know this was a complaint in the past that the person has to ask the clerk what has happened.
Nimefungwa
ama nimewachiliwa.
Where do I go now? Am I allowed to stand?
Or which date was given by the court?
Yeah.
So now we know that we have to project our voices so
and
that
be
we
clear.
Are, so and be clearer. When COVID came, it is the CUCs that influenced the decisions on whether to close or not close because there is COVID, has been
outbreak
seen
in an area,
and then in an area, or even the decisions on how the CUC would operate, within that, and then within that framework of COVID. I then worked in Kibra, and I will tell you that how we embraced the virtual platform. We had to involve the CUCs. We had to find out what is the capacity of every actor. I mean, like prisons, do you have sufficient equipment? Do you have this? Police officers, do you have the sufficient infrastructure for you to be able to have virtual charge sheets presented, and then the ODPP to have a collection point where they will now look at the charge sheets that are coming from the stations and then make the decision to charge and then forward it to us in the courts. So all these required a great synergy between all the actors. So there has been quite a lot that has happened and a very big, very big leap, because we are having a conversation. I may not know your challenges until you speak them.
Sure. Yeah.
Like as we sit here, I just learned that the word court has a different meaning. Mm. So,
you know, everything that you've said not only makes sense, but it's music to the ears of a simple citizen like myself. But what I often find puzzling is whether or how it is, or the mechanism that can be used so that the wider public understands these things. Let me explain why I'm asking the question. When I raise the question of politicians, these are the group of people who actually talk to the Mwananchi more than almost anybody else, because they rely on the Mwananchi for survival and for their jobs. So they will communicate. Now, when the central representative says someone like a manager of a CDF, that person is limited. He's a manager of a CDF, and he deals with only CDF issues. But issues to do with the public, what the public wants, what the public thinks. Chiefs are useful because they are barazas and they talk to people. Because so long as you have these committees and people within the committees understand what is going on, but the so-called Mwananchi, is there a forum, is there a platform, is there a passage that is followed to ensure that this information actually is cascaded so that the very basic unit of the Mwananchi has an opportunity? They may not take the opportunity, but the opportunity is there for them to understand.
Thank you, Muga. Number one, we have not seen some CUCs, like the one I now chair, has an MCA as a member. The MCA as a member. The Member of Parliament is a member and has built, we had a deficit of something within the station, and through the CDF funds, provided money and built washrooms for the ablution unit for the members of the public who come to that court. I know that the court in Mutomo was actually built by CDF, because they had a conversation and then they built. We know about Kenol recently, that was built by CDF and then given to the judiciary. So I want to say that the politicians have participated thoroughly in CUC activities. But your question is very valid in terms of, do we reach the Mwananchi? We have what is called judiciary open days. And the open days are at the localized levels. And each open day, they could be thematic, they could have a theme. For example, if the discussion is on children, you would have a theme. Most in November, you would have seen in the judiciary website, there have been quite a number of CUCs across the country holding some one open day or the other on the theme of children, because November was the month for children. And in the open day, I have participated in very many open days, because at the privileged position that I sit as chair, we have partnered with other actors to put open days in various places in the country. The first of this was in Nyando. And typically, you would have the agencies on the ground. You would find the police station coming with their OB there. They are showing you how we record in the OB. And this is how we do it. When you come, this is how you will be. The prison, this is how you will be. Your report will
this,
be.
This is how you will be imprisoned.
No, this is how your book will be kept and stuff like that. For prison, they will even tell you, if you, unfortunately, you end up in prison, this is how we do. And then the training that we give, and this is the product of the training that we give to the people who are in prison. And then they will have some of the wares and stuff like that. And they will take the opportunity also to have a few of them sold. And we would have the judiciary will have all the registries. This is the succession registry. This is our registry for traffic. This is our registry for this. This is what we do in this.
Your Honor, how often do you have open days?
You know, these are really engaging moments, but typically it should be, if a court works properly within its mandate and work plan, they should be able to have at least an open day in a year.
Now, I remember the Chief Justice talking about alternative conflict resolution mechanisms, the semblance of a court system within a community setting, training so that people understand certain basics of the law so that they can discharge judicial functions at that level, so that the higher courts, as in the magistrates' courts onward, are not clogged, if I understood it correctly. The reason why I bring this up is when you have anything that is that community-based, already you have simple lay wananchi in a position where they are performing a function that people can relate to. I'm saying this because communication is not so much, well, talking is a key component of it, but nothing works better than the power of example when they see it actually working. So when a service is cascaded to that level, the very principles we're talking about are much clearer understood, because they'll be dealing with cases of chicken, somebody who has dug a meter into someone else's compound, somebody who, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So the very processes that are followed in the larger courts are the same processes that you'll be talking about. And when they interact with these processes at their level, the understanding, in my mind, is deepened. Am I on the right track or have I missed the boat completely?
I will not be a judge in that issue of whether you've missed the boat, but I want to just say this, that we in the judiciary acknowledge the fact that we are not the first point of call for resolution of disputes. As a matter of fact, majority of the disputes are resolved first at home. Your daughter is slapping the other one, so you tell them, you stop it. You know that first and foremost, slapping another is an assault. So by you should report. But you have resolved that dispute. It's a criminal matter, but it's been resolved. Right. I'm giving you at a very basic level. So some are resolved at religious leaders. They call them headmen. There is always plural. It's headmen or assistant chief and his men. But by the time a problem comes to us in the court, it's usually a majority of them would have gone through these processes. That is the reason why we have a committee chaired by Justice Professor Joel Ngugi. It's called the Alternative Justice Systems Committee. And that is trying to entrench alternative justice. I'm from the Turkana community, so my community is very oral, and in their dispute resolution mechanism, they're very advanced. They know how to, very advanced. We know how to resolve disputes by nature.
Because there were so many.
No, it's because it's because of being very peripheral and not having interacted.
So you had to have your own alternative.
No. System. So theirs developed. Without interference with concept. For example, the concept of prison does not exist in most African culture. Imprisonment does not exist as a component. So you would want to know why banishment, even the death penalty, if you were to look at it very closely and critically, you would see that death was not the greatest. Would be banishment,
ostracization.
You are ostracized. So that committee is actually looking at how to resolve certain cadre of cases. And of course, we must now, there's of course a check to it, which is that it must not be the repugnancy issue. It must not be repugnant to justice and morality. That's a very huge test to it. So as you say, but our courts are open courts. One of the things that CUC has entrenched is to ensure that we don't do things in camera except where the law provides for example, handling children cases, handling cases of persons who are vulnerable, divorce cases. Even just reporting divorce cases, we don't give you the names. We just give you initials. We say AWM versus PQT. And we know that they know themselves. Yep. PQ knows himself. AW knows. I'm assuming PQ would be the man. And so that's how we have entrenched.
Mm.
But our court system is open. Everybody comes in, and we allow them to sit with us talk to us.
As we conclude the conversation, then, Your Honor, what should we look out for? I mean, now we are seeing the court users committees. I can say that you have gotten to a level of maturity. So in about a minute, so paint a picture for us in about 4 or 5 years' time. What should we expect to see from our justice system emanating from the fact that we have robust court users committees?
Thank you very much. First, we have very key successes that have shown us that working together has produced successes. For example, in our court users committees, we have those that are now benchmarking is not a word that everybody likes, but they benchmark with each other.
Mm.
You want to best practices, you want to go there and find what is best that works. So the next level, for the last several years, the committee has been trying to entrench court user committee as a platform.
Mm.
Now, moving forward, it's now a monitoring and evaluation, and then ensuring that the court user committees generate the agenda for the National Council. So that as they sit there, so that it is the, like you say, it is the Mwananchi who would be speaking from the lowest level upward, so that the council will be discussing issues which has generated generally from the ground. We are developing what is called a toolkit on communication, and ensuring that we now report more, so that it is now, when you report, if it is not spoken of, it didn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the reason we are now moving towards reporting a lot more of what court user committees do, and then doing a monitoring and evaluation, ensuring that whatever it is that we do follows a certain layer of this is the action, this was what needed to be done, this was done. It is in a work plan of some kind, and then that the issues there are now more standard. We would like a standard operation so that when you are a chair of court A and you move to court B, The transition is seamless, and there is no shocks.
Mm.
Yeah, and I think this is where court user committees are headed.
Asante sana. Thank you very much for joining us today on this Justice Thursday. Come again soon for more progress on this.
There was a lot more, and yes, I think we will continue with this conversation.
Asante.
Thank you very much for having me.
The Honorable Chief Magistrate Abdulkadir Lorot is a chairperson of the National Council on Administration of Justice Special Committee on Court Users Committees. And he's been with us today to demystify justice through court user committees. We have gotten to a level of understanding of what court users committees are. And now we hope to see, you know, better administration of justice going into the future. Thank you very much for joining us, the Honorable Chief Magistrate. See you again soon.
This is The Situation Room. The only way to start your day.